Well, good to see such a big group of people. So welcome to the Airflow Meetup, hosted at GDD today. Today I will give an introduction into Airflow. For those who are not familiar with Airflow, it's like a workflow orchestration tool. Let's see some hands who have worked with Airflow. It's familiar with it? Yeah? A bit? Yeah? Okay. I will start at the beginning, so if you don't have any experience, you don't have to, you'll just learn it along the way. First part will be a bit more theoretical, and then we'll move to the more practical part where we'll also do some code. If there are any questions, please just ask them right away. So this is the first time I do this this Airflow meetup or the Airflow talk. So if things are not clear, just fire away. So first, the obligatory slide about myself. So I studied computer science at the University of Groningen. I worked for a short time at the Katowice in Assen, but then I decided to move to Amsterdam. So I work as a Go Data Driven as a data engineer. I help people with setting up their ETL, their processes, their bringing their models to production, stuff like that. So I'm actually a member of the Apache Airflow committer group. So if you have any cool features that you want to integrate into Airflow, just ping me and I will merge them right away. And I also do a lot of other stuff to the open source community. I really love open source, like people who are just building software without any centralized organizations, just nice energy. I did some stuff for Flink and Spark. So most of the time when you have like data pipelines, it's like a complex graph of all these dependencies that depend on each other. And you have to do first get some data from an external source and then do some cleaning of it. And then you can insert it in your model. And the more complicated it gets, it can get messy at a certain time. And then you want to orchestrate it. So in today's world, when you look at the big companies, their data pipelines are just mission critical. If something breaks down and, for example, you don't have any reporting from the day before, then you have some angry managers at your desk screaming why the data is not processed. So it's getting more and more important, and therefore it's more, you have to monitor it more. Personally, I don't like monitoring troubleshooting. So if that can make made easy, then I really like that. So this is where Airflow steps in. So Airflow helps you with your workflow scheduling. So if you have a complex pipeline of operations, you can use Airflow to execute it and to monitor it. It has been developed by Airbnb in 2015 by this guy Maxime started it, and then later on it became an Apache project. It can be used for simple ETLing, but you can also, for example, retrain your models using Airflow and have a nice overview of what's going on. It's used by 120 companies plus. The list is on the GitHub page. So if you start using it, please also add your company to it, because it helps us in our Apache process. So what does Airflow do? It monitors the process. So if you have a hierarchy of processes, it will just start executing the first one and then all the way through. It maintains your logs. So if you have, for example, we all know these processes where we make these cron jobs, and then we pipe the output to some kind of file. And if the process fails, then you have to check these files. But if you have a lot of jobs running, then this can get quite ugly. It handles the connections and credentials. So for example, if you connect to a Postgres machine, you want to have your passwords stored on a safe place. This is all stored inside of Airflow, encrypted. And when when your job fails, for example, at midnight, you try to get a dump from your local MySQL machine, and it fails because the MySQL machine was not available, then you can configure Airflow to retry the job, for example, 1 hour later, or as you like. And it does resource pooling. So if, for example, if you ETL from a database, database can sometimes be fragile and don't want to open like 200 connections at one at a time and just pull all the data out. So you can also use Airflow to pull these resources. I will give an example of this later. So what are typical things that you would do with Airflow? So for example, like I said, ETLing. You want to have a scheduled job that does the ETL every day. You want to take this data, clean it, maybe do some aggregations on it and store it somewhere, or create reports or whatever. To do feature extraction. For example, if you have like a lot of data, you want to maybe extract some features out of it and just store them separately so that the data scientist can work with it. Train models, you can use Airflow to schedule the process of training your models. For example, if you have multiple steps, this it's nice to have Airflow to do this for you. And shipping stuff to production. So if you have, for example, some kind of data that you want to make an export for every day, it's very easy to do this with Airflow. So when we think about these processes, what is important? So one thing is scalability. You don't want to run everything on one machine. For example, machines can fail. So you want to be able to scale it out. Airflow is able to do this. Same goes for availability. If one machine goes down, then you don't want your ETL to stop, because then you have the angry manager the next day at your desk. Alert enabled. This means when something goes wrong, you want to be alerted. For example, if you try to pull data from somewhere and it doesn't work, or the data format has changed and one of the jobs fails, you want to get like a email or a Slack message. Error recovery. Like I said, if one of for example, one of the external processes you're connecting to is not available, then you want to retry it for a fixed number of times. If it doesn't work, then you want to get notified. And correctness. Like this is like sometimes it can be hard. For example, if you incrementally, for example, export data out of a database, that you want to make sure that you capture all the whole time span. For example, if you download 1 year of data, you don't want to miss out a few days, because that will mess up your data set. So let's talk about how Airflow, how you can implement this in Airflow. So the basic operators, the Airflow primitives of Airflow, are a DAG, the operator itself, a sensor, and hooks. And the top three are the most important. So let's start with the DAG. A DAG is a, you might have heard the term before, it's a directed acyclic graph. So it's actually like a graph which is directed. So for example, if you have job A, that can have a dependency on job B, or can have multiple dependencies on other jobs. We will see this more visually later on when I will fire up Airflow itself. A DAG is scheduled periodically. So you can have like a fixed time interval. So I want to run this job every 5 minutes, want to run it every day. And what's important about this is that it is decoupled from the local time right now. So for example, if you want to say, I want to get 1 year of data in increments of 1 day, then you can just start like a job, like it was like 1 year ago, 1 year plus 1 day, 1 year plus 2 days. We'll see an example of this later. And it encapsulates dependencies. Like if you have like dependencies on jobs, for example, we first have to get a job before, then get the data before we clean it. There's a very, very clear dependency. But if you don't do this right, then you might kick off, for example, the data cleaning job when there's no data, and then the job might even run and complete successfully, but then you don't have any data that you are cleaning. So then we go to the operators. The Airflow chains like operators together to create this dependency of of operations. This can be very broad, but a couple of them are, for example, the bash operator, where you can just execute shell. Docker, you can run containers. You can do Hive operations. You can do HTTP requests, connect to databases, all the Amazon stuff. And you can also fire notifications or just execute plain Python functions. And there's also like a really big variety of contributed features. So for example, we see a lot of companies nowadays, for example, Qbol. It's like, I don't know, they do some kind of data processing. I don't know actually what they do. But they hired a guy and he's just implementing like all the Qbol operations inside of Airflow. Same goes for Databricks, the guys from Spark. They now have like this this online Databricks environment where you can just get Spark as a service. And they implement all the operators to use Airflow to Spark. So for example, that you can say from Airflow every morning at midnight, I want to kick off this specific Spark job inside my Databricks environment. And it's also quite easy to develop an operator yourself. So for example, if you have like a feature that's missing, if you're using some more arcane technology, then yeah, it's quite easy to provide an operator yourself. So the hooks, there's some kind of hierarchy. So for example, you have an operator. An operator can use multiple hooks, and a hooks is just a connection. So for example, you also see the Hive to the Druid operator that uses a Hive hook and a Druid hook. And this is a bit more low level, but it's nice to understand it because sometimes you see quite specialized operators like Hive to Druid, but you could also say I want a Hive to Presto operator. And then you can, for example, replace the Druid hook with a Presto hook. And then you can also do, for example, a Hive to Presto exports. This involves some coding, but yeah, if you're missing something, it's quite easy to implement actually. And then we come to sensors. So, sip of coffee. So a sensor is that senses external state. So for example, if you have like a Spark job and you run it and you tell it, okay, write my output to AGFS. When it's done, it will create this underscore success job file. And then you know, okay, this job has run successfully. And now I can use this data that I've been waiting for to use this as an input for my next job. So for example, sometimes you get data in from FTP and then you have to wait sometimes like at 1 a.m. Midnight, sometimes at 3 a.m. midnight. And can use a sensor to sense the external state and to make sure that, for example, that file on the FTP that you're waiting for, that is actually there. So for example, you also have like a HTTP sensor that you can wait. Okay, I want to curl this HTTP, this URL, and make sure that a specific response is given back. Huh? Does it make sense? I see Niels smiling a bit. Huh?
Oh yeah, it does.
So, this was the theory. Let's go to some examples. So I created this. This example repository. I think I still have to push it to Git. Yeah, let's make it a bit bigger. Better? Yeah, cool. So I created an example that you can also try yourself. It's not on GitHub yet. It's quite annoying, this thing. It's for the... So with this host, that will just run like Airflow on your local machine. Should not use this in production, but for a local machine, it works quite well. And it's a nice way to play around with, do some experimentation of different Airflow decks. And are you often familiar with Docker? So this consists of a couple of containers. So the first one is Redis. That's used for message passing. So for example, if you have a distributed setup of Airflow, it will use Python Celery to distribute the task among the cluster. So this, and you need Redis as a backend for reliable message passing. So when a new job gets kicked off, it will pass a message to Redis, and then workers will be listening on this Redis queue, and then it will pick up the job. You need a database backend. You can do Postgres, you can do MySQL, and you can also do SQLite, but you should not use SQLite in production. It's more for if you want to do a CI on Airflow. I've seen people using then the SQLite environment because you can just throw it away. So the web server, this is just that hosts the UI of Airflow. So all the jobs you can just monitor using this website that will fire up in a minute. So you have Flower. This is like a UI for Celery. So if you're debugging your cluster because some jobs that get not kicked off, then you can open up Flower to see if, for example, our jobs are still in the queue, are they picked up, and who's listening on the job queue. So this is the scheduler. This is the real heart of the Airflow. This one looks at, okay, do I need to schedule new jobs? For example, is it past midnight and I need to run a new job? Then the scheduler will create these jobs and schedule them for the workers. If something's wrong, you might want to tell the scheduler's log. And they have the workers. The workers do the actual job. So Airflow passes like a job definition to the worker. And then it tells the worker, okay, I have this job definition, which can be, for example, anything. Like, for example, pull this data from Postgres, execute this Python function, fire up this Hive query or whatever you like. And this is the one that you can scale out. So, for example, if you have like if you do a lot of heavy jobs, then you want to create multiple workers across multiple machines. Maybe I still have it running. Yeah. Yeah, this is the job that I created. So when you open up the UI, you get this list. This is the list of all the jobs that you have in your DAX folder. Yeah, as you can see, it's just an overview. It tells that it will be scheduled daily. We had 3 successful runs and 1 that has failed. I will tell you in a minute why. Oh, wait. I will just start from clean state. It's a much bit better. I still had it open. So I will just clean up the Doc Compose. So when you run this at home and you want to try it out, then you get the same state. So there are some steps that you have to configure before it works. And in the state that I just had, it was already configured, but let's do it together.
I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
So as far I never worked with Airflow, but as far as I understand now, this is an orchestrating framework for managing different types of data processing jobs.
Yeah.
And you can use different frameworks as like a pieces of this stack, let's say.
Yeah.
Might be used like you have your Spark jobs and you want to synchronize these jobs between each other.
Yeah.
Then you build this pipeline to orchestrate and manage the successful completion of each stage, and Airflow is the tool.
Exactly. Yeah. You can compare it for.
And then it also manages the cluster of the where to deploy it multi-node and the infrastructure.
You have to do that yourself, so you have to exactly, yeah, under the hood, Airflow just executes a shell, and for example, use Python to just execute the Python commands. So, if you have a setup where you do everything on a Yarn cluster or something, then your Airflow cluster should not be too big because all the work is being done on the Airflow machines. But if you do, for example, also seen like a model training on Airflow where you do a lot of Panda stuff, and then you might want to scale out your cluster because that will have a heavy load on the machine itself.
Okay, and it means that each node of this deck has its own responsibility to manage resources on this step.
Yeah.
So like for example, if one of my steps is Spark, then Spark is responsible for managing its own resources.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. My laptop's a bit slow, but I don't know really why. Normally this is instantaneously. Yeah.
What's the difference between what you're doing with Docker Compose and the power of like dumb install Airflow?
Gun install?
Conda install Airflow.
So Conda, yeah.
I get the Uflow, I get the UI, I get the scheduler, and a bunch of other things in the background happening.
Normally when you just do pip install Airflow, it also works.
Yeah.
Then you get like a very basic setup that uses the sequential executor. We'll come to this later. But that's like everything is in one process. It also works, but this is a bit more fancy where you have like a separate web server, separate scheduler, and separate workers.
So everything if I just do pip install, everything's happening inside one process, as opposed to.
Yeah, if you just start it, then you have everything inside one process.
Right.
You have to do some config. Yeah.
Sometimes it fails or sometimes it doesn't.
Yeah.
Can you pull that data and then also, if a success happens, mirror it back to another database or have them connect more than just a success failure? Or is this?
Airflow just looks at the exit code. So if it's exit code 0, then it's awk. And it will continue with the execution of the DAG. Mm-hmm. And if it's unequal to 0, then it will just fail. And depending on your configuration of the DAG, it will retry it later on, or it will just give a hard fail, and then It will send an email. This XCOM that then can pass data to the operators. Yeah, it's okay for a bit of data, for example, metadata. But most of the time, you would just do something and store it back to S3 or ACFS or something like that. Yes. It's not better to just. This is better. So this is the deck that I created as an example. So it runs daily. I'm the owner of it. It didn't run anything and there's no last run. So it's actually also just disabled. So let's enable it and see what happens. So you can click on the DAG itself, and this is right now our DAG. So first we do say hi, what actually does it echoes some stuff in the bash operator, but it also resets the state. I will come to the code later on. Then we pull some data from Postgres, and then we do some Spark operations. This is really simple, but I think it captures the essence of Airflow quite well. So you can also see on the top we have a bash operator, which is this one, the Postgres operators, which are these ones, and we have the Spark submit operator, which is this one, and it just submits like a Spark job. And we can also see that the edges of the blocks are colored. This one has successfully executed, it's green. These ones are scheduled, of queued. So this one this instance is created by the scheduler to say, okay, if one of the workers has some available slots, please go execute this task. And this one has no status because the jobs upstream are not executed. So these are still waiting to be executed. And you can also see that like there's a data dependency. So what we see now is that they got a different color. It's now in a retry state. Yeah. Let's see what happened. You can click on the operator, and then you get this modal. This has been fixed in a recent pull request, so don't pay too much attention to it. Then we can go to the log. So all the standard out and the standard error is just captured inside of this log, and you can go through it. And as you can see, it could not find the server because it's not running on localhost. So like I said before, inside Airflow, we have all our connections that are just managed inside of Airflow. And if a job gets kicked off, it will be passed into to the execution. Let's fix our Postgres configuration. So it's not running on localhost, but it's running on Postgres. Schema is Airflow, login is Airflow, and I think you can guess the password. So now we've fixed the connection, and now we can say, okay, we want to try the job again. Now it's green. now we can see that it actually executed the job. So now I can also clear the other one. Normally it's now in retry state, so based on your retry strategy, in this case it will retry it automatically in 1 hour, and it will be rescheduled then. So if we refresh it, you see it will just continue to execute. And then we have the same problem for Spark. Tries to execute on Yarn, but unfortunately I don't have a Yarn cluster inside of my Docker environment. So then we do the same thing. Let's do it local.
Does Airflow populate that list of connections automatically based on your Python, or do you have to open them one by one?
By default, it only populates default connections. You can add them, for example, using your CLI. So, for example, if you provision your machine, all your machines with Ansible, you can just do the Airflow connections add, and you can add connections. And what we see a lot, for example, if you have like a dev test exceptions production environment, you have like different connection strings for each environment. And that's something that you can just easily manage inside of your Airflow DAG. So for example, if you want to have the identical DAG for your test environment, you don't only have to replace like the connection strings to make sure that it points to the test database instead of the production database.
Okay, so it seems that you have a Spark submit operator, so write to the default connection thing for Spark.
Yeah. Yeah, we see a lot of connections here also, like BigQuery and Hive and MSSQL, and that we don't use them, but because there's like a MSSQL operator, it will also populate like a MSSQL connection with some default credentials, which will never connect, of course, unless you have like a local host MySQL running without a password.
But it can't read the configure files, I guess.
What kind of a...
Well, let's say if you have a Postgres database running on the same system,
yeah,
it's not going to look for the configuration files for that server.
No.
And read them. So you have to put them yourself.
Yeah. There are also credentials like your passwords. You should only put them in Airflow, so they're not on the system itself.
Sure.
So for example, if you have the distributed environment where you have like the salary executor, you have like 10 worker nodes, you want to make sure that the passwords are only in the Postgres of Airflow and not on the machines itself. We can so now I can see that it picked up the new connection. Oh, it still fails. Sorry? No, but I'm curious.
Also, high performance clusters,
yeah,
the SunGrid engine to manage batch jobs.
Yeah.
I was thinking maybe you could use Airflow to run your workflows on such HPCs as well.
Yeah, sure. I think it's not supported out of the box, so then you have to create a custom operator.
I'm wondering if that's something people do. I'll just search a little bit for it and find it.
Okay. Yeah, I know that people use Airflow for anything. Like I also saw systems like this service desk. They had like a ticket coming in, And Airflow would notice that, and there would be an Airflow job that would pick it up. And then they had all kind of sensors like, oh, there's a ticket, there's some kind of a log file created somewhere. And it would do all kinds of, I'm not really familiar with the service desk operations, but they also used it for such kind of things. Yeah. So if you can execute, for example, such a job with from a shell or SSH, then it should be easy to implement. Yeah.
So.
So let's look at the code. Personally, I find it really nice that your workflow is just defined in code. It's not like with Uzi where you have like these giant XMLs. And this gives you really some flexibility that, in my opinion, is quite nice. It also feels a bit, if you're familiar with Python code, it feels a bit more natural. So I suggest we just run through the code and to see how you would define such a DAG. So first of all, you import all the operators that you need. I always use like this current here. It takes the absolute path of the directory. There's a technical reason to do this, because what Airflow actually does, when it executes a job, it creates like a temporary directory where it puts all the dependencies on your /temp/, and then like a random string of numbers, your Airflow job. And if you want to, for example, read SQL from an absolute path on a machine, then you have to use this current there. I have this small helper function named clean name that will clean up like a string. We'll use it later, I will explain it then. They have some default arguments. That's a dict that you pass to your DAG itself. So for example, you can say who is the owner, and some email address that you want to use when something fails. Then if you have SMTP configured, then you get an email. I disabled it because I don't have any SMTP configured. And this owner is also quite handy when you have like, for example, if you look at Airbnb, they have like hundreds of DAGs, and then you want to know, okay, who is the creator of this DAG or the maintainer of this DAG. Can specify the number of retries. In this case, I specified it at 2. And if it fails, then it will retry in 1 hour. So then you get the DAG object itself. So you can give it a name that should be unique within the DAG folder. You can give a schedule interval. At this time, I just had it run daily. But you can just use cron notation here. If you're familiar with cron notation, which you use normally for your cron jobs. Start date, super important. I will come to it later, but if you want to do backfilling, then you should. So, for example, you have a data source that's coming in from 2016 on, and today you want to decide to write a job for it. Then you can just let it start in 2016 and as well just create jobs from that moment on. And you have to pass the default arguments. So this is the DAG itself. So we have the DAG object. First you do a bash operator. And you can specify a bash command. So you can also template it using Ninja2 templating. We are familiar with Python. We have like two packages. This is important. This is, so we see like we have the airflow.operators and airflow.contrib.operators. The Ninja2 templating works quite well in the operators itself. But if it's from contrib, it might sometimes break because it's not implemented. So for example, if you have a Spark SQL job and you want to template it, in 1.9 it will work, but previously not. So our first operator is a bash operator, which we have a unique ID. It's called say hi. The bash operator is just first an echo, and then we do a rmrf in these directories. First we throw it away, and then we create again to create a nice clean state. Then we have the second operator, which is Spark submit operator. You can just pass an application, Spark analysis.py, and the task ID is perform Spark analysis. And then we do a glob. So this is a searching listing a directory. So we look into the slash SQL slash star.sql. So we take all the SQL files and we read them. We take the query. We replace the new lines with spaces, because otherwise it cannot handle the new lines. We take the SQL file and we clean it, so we get a table name. And then we create for each of the SQL files that's inside of this folder, we create a Postgres operator, which we give the name, so the task ID remains unique. And we pass a SQL query to it, and we reference the DAG. And this is where you set your dependencies. So first we have the init, which is the say hi. Then we do the Postgres operator and the Spark analysis. Sorry?
How do you define the complex structure? Because with errors, it's not that easy to build a tree or graph.
Yeah, in this case, you can. There are two ways of defining it. Personally, I find this the most intuitive way. You say, like, okay, I want to have this structure. But you also have like this other notation where you can say, I want to set upstream or set downstream. So then you can say, okay, I want to execute this job before this other job. And then you can just so for example, if you would say like so these two notations are equivalent, but here you explicitly said like I want to downstream this one, or you can say it the other way around. This one is exactly identical to this one. And using these operators, you should be able to create every DAG or tree or graph that you want. Sure. Actually, when you change something, for example, you can save this. So we've broken the dependency now. And there's a loop in the back that checks if something has changed. Or you can explicitly refresh it. And then it updates automatically. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, it was just a general question. Sounds like if export from one table would be 1 hour.
Yeah.
And you want to just create a new table and to execute your Spark job. So when I do update my graph in DAG definition,
yes.
Would it reverberate only the last pass, or would it export the whole deck and start again?
In this case, you can see it's the tree view. It's a bit harder to interpret. On the x-axis is the time, So for example, this is the, we start at 12 December, this 13 December, it's 14 December. What you can see here, these runs are still active. So as long as the run is active and you would change anything, then it would impact that DAG. But I would not really recommend updating DAGs when they're running, because yeah, it's a bit tricky.
Yeah, but when usually when you start using something, you make an errors.
Yeah, sure.
Of course, you will report.
Yeah. Yeah, what I would recommend is just change it and say, for example, I was expecting a newer version. This is 1.8.1 stable, and I'm running 1.9 in production. But then you can click on the deck run. So for example, the whole deck run, and it can clear it, and it will just start over again.
So should I each phase separately, or suppose?
Yeah, depends. If you want to rerun everything, then you should clear the whole deck. And you can do that using the CLI, and I will actually explain it later in the process. Yeah. Yeah, you cannot.
Your DAG itself, the operator itself, you could make like checks. So, like an incremental job, check if a particular file already exists and skip it. You get what I'm saying? If you have this 1 month of data process, you just implement a check, which checks, okay, do I actually need to fetch this particular day? If not,
like,
then I'll
fetch. It looks like I'm adding additional work on top of the effort just to make everything.
Yeah, so typically what we do is change it to version 2 and then just wait a bit longer. The nice thing is with the version 2 is that you make this active, you delete the first one, and you can go back to the version 0. So.
But that's kind of basic feature, though. So I guess that that's what's not really in the use case of the original design. To touch individual jobs, like in my use case, this is critical use.
Importance. Yeah, but the problem is that Airflow doesn't know about any story, right? Yeah. It just triggers separate operators one after each other after all the dependencies are resolved. So because it doesn't have a definition of storage, it doesn't even know how to check if a particular job already ran. It only depends on these exit codes, like Popper just said. If it is a valid exit code, then the job went okay, and we can continue with all the jobs.
Of course, you can do fancy stuff, but then you have to code it yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah, like Nils was saying.
In your example, are you saying you want to change the code, or you just want to process like 30 days of a set?
Yeah, I want to change some querying one table from one table or just a new table and execute start of job. I just don't want to execute all the steps again because it would be quite time consuming, right?
Yeah, but you could do, for example, if you have a, if you want to say, I want to do it from a specific date. Oh. It doesn't exist anymore because I changed the name. Yeah, what I would then recommend is like Airflow 102, so I will not go too much in depth to it. It's like, so you can also branch. So it's not only like that you can go downhill, but you can also make like, for example, you have, if you have a branch, you say, okay, I want to do this because the external state, for example, the data is already there. Yeah, it's not super. It's not super clear, but for example, this is the branching operator. It's the Python branching operator, which is just implemented using a Python function, and it will take a branch depending on the return value. For example, if you have a, if this Python function that you execute, it might check Hive or if something is already processed or AGFS, and it returns branch underscore A as in its return statement, then it will take this branch. So, for example, yeah, if you want to do this, then you can use like this Python branching operator to check the state, and depending on the external state, reprocess the data again, or just decide to that's already processed, and just skip the processing part, and that's taking a lot of time. Yeah, the branch operator is a if else. But with the branching operator, it will only take one branch. For example, it will only execute branch A and then do the join again, and it will never execute this. And with the example that I show here, it will always execute both of the branches in parallel. So this is just like the dependency, like it has to do this thing first, and then it can just do everything downstream in parallel, as long as all the dependencies have met.
Could you potentially do, so if you go to tree view?
So let me fix the...
If you go to the tree view, one of the things that I've done, I don't know if this would work, is if I update the code for one of the parts,
yeah. We say clear here, and this is also clear downstream and recursive.
I know, but also past and future. So that you also, so if you had, for example, you wanted to run from the second day onwards, you could say clear, and that would be
So it's clear everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. So now it will just execute all the days again. And what most of the time is important when doing ETL is like, doing, they call it like that you're not touching external state, so that you have like clean, pure ETL. And that's something that we do, for example, in the Postgres operator. Let me see if I can get the other view back. So when doing a daily dump, you also want to make sure that you only get one single day. So for example, you can, using Jinja templating, you can template your SQL queries. For example, this DS, that will be templated using the execution date. So if you look at this, and this is one of our Postgres operators. If we look at the render tab, there you can see that it actually templated the SQL with the date. And it also will write to this table called slash data slash date slash logs CSV. And this will be ensured that if you run all these operations, you can just run them in parallel. So they will not interfere with each other. And this will also make sure that if all the runs are green, that you have all the data. We use this, for example, a lot when you have, for example, a big database and you want to add a column, and you add this column in the export, and then you just clear all the runs, and it will just start running all the jobs again, and then it will incrementally add like this column. Yeah, also what I really like about Airflow is the programmatic interface. So for example, if you have defined a nice job and you say van okay, I want to add another export.
Can you zoom into your terminal?
Yeah, sure. So right now I'm just exporting like the database of Airflow itself, so it's a bit meta. So let's look into the container. Oh.
It's picking up.
So right now we have a we have two exports, one the deck run and the log. And let's also just see if we can do an export of this one. So this is the job table. So we have a start date. Should make a hotkey of that. Now let's say we also want to export like the job table. Let's like take the start date as the partition key. That's nice because the start date will never change. So once it started, hey, it will always start like in the future, and it will never be updated. So that's a nice way of importing everything. Say to go to job CSV. So then we see that it adds one of the operators automatically. There's a Flask interface in front of it, and it sometimes has some caching, so sometimes you have to refresh a couple of times. And right now it will just retry within 1 hour. Something's wrong. I think I didn't save it. This is like execution error, so I'm sure that the syntax is okay. So now we can clear the job again. Then we can see that it will just we'll add another dependency. What I did, because the Python code that we defined will just look into this directory called SQL. Because I added another job there, it will automatically pick up this this job from the directory and add it like as a separate operator.
And it's expecting all of those as Jinja templates.
The nice thing about having the ability to template it with Jinja is that you can just make this daily dumps. So you can clear all the jobs and we'll just refresh it for the history, but it will also continue like in the future. It is much more scalable instead of having like a full dump every day, especially if you have like production systems. They don't want to really like it that you pull so much data from production databases or read-only slaves. Yeah, it's really easy. Now this is like a Postgres operator, but if you have like a production system, you most of the time have like the scoop operator or like a Spark job that just pulls like data from the relational database. And even with scoop, it's really easy to like to open so much connections to these database that they will easily crash. So that's something that you want to do small daily exports, for example. Yeah, let's continue on that. For example, if you have like a Postgres operator, and I would like let's say I want to get data from 16, 1st of January. I create a new one for it. Okay, now it will create like new jobs with running in 2016, 1st of January. And when you look at I have to click on the Postgres one, of course. When you look at the query, it will also template like this date in there. I will just stop it for a minute. What you can see already, it's like scheduling like crazy. And if I would let it run, it would open like, now you have my laptop already, it would open like a lot of connections to Postgres. Yeah, and that's something that we don't want, because if you open like 200 connections to Postgres, and if you have a big Airflow cluster, it can like be 2,000 connections, then the Postgres will die, and you don't want to do that. So this is something that Airflow has thought of. Let me just plug in for a moment. So this is where we can use a pool. A pool is like a set number of connections, and this is where the schedule will keep into account. Like, for example, if you want to say, okay, I got this connection from a database administrator, and he only allows me to have like 8 parallel connections. Now let's say 4, a bit less. And you can say, I want to make a pool. You can give it a unique name. Let's name it Postgres, and say, have it 4 slots. So then we can extend the DAG definition. Oh, it's super small. By saying, okay, I want to have this Postgres operator run into a pool called Postgres. These pools are shared among DAGs. So for example, you have another DAG that also connects to Postgres. It will also be in the same pool. So globally, for the whole Airflow machine, the scheduler will never schedule more than 4 operations that are in the Postgres pool. In the UI, you have to create the pools. You can also do it using CLI. But this is just with the connections, it's just creating like the connections and the pools. And now we have a pool, the pool is defined. Then we can use it inside of our DAG definition, where we can say, okay, I want to have this Postgres operator use this Postgres pool. And maybe you can also say, okay, I want to limit the number of spark jobs, because otherwise, if you have like a yarn cluster with that's not configured really good with resource sharing and has a lot of that it will kill other containers and to share resources. Preemption, that was the word that I'm looking for. Then you can say, okay, I also want to limit airflow to not like schedule 200 jobs on my yarn cluster, because it doesn't really make sense. Yarn will cope with it, but sometimes you can say, okay, yeah, I want to limit it. So that can also do with Postgres, because you don't want too many connections to your Postgres machine. And this is where you create the pools, but you can also do it using the CLI. So let's use this nice. Now we can see like this one is Postgres, this one is Postgres, this one is Postgres. And now we see 2 running jobs, but it will never schedule more than 4 jobs in parallel. Does that make sense? Is this useful for you? You want to see that you want to don't want to flood your machines? Not exactly 4. And what's also important, sometimes you don't want to have this backfilling behavior. Like a lot of people also use Airflow to train their models. Sometimes you don't want to backfill. For example, if you're training a model and the process was stuck like for a couple of days, and you clear it again and you restart the scheduled offline model training, you don't want to create like 6 models. So you can also easily disable this behavior. I guess I and now it will not. I can clear it. Maybe it's even better to create a new one. So this is just a hack. Incrementing this number will just let Airflow, I will fool Airflow that like this is a new DAG, and it will just create a new instance for it. But it's not something that Niels does it in practice, but these DAGs are now broken. Like if you click on it, you will get the 500 stack trace I think it's a mushroom cloud ASCII. Oh, I think I know what I did wrong.